The principal crops of this season were corn and beans. One who saw it says that Swilling had about 15 acres of as fine of corn as might be seen in any of the western states. In no season since have our farmers been able to raise so good a crop of corn. Salt River Herald, May 11th, 1878.
On July 4th, 1870, Jack Swilling, gold prospector, rogue, and itinerant soldier for hire, founded the Swilling Irrigation Company and began homesteading near the nexus of the Salt and Gila Rivers. Soon, others followed. Swilling realized he could use the ancient canals found near the rivers to irrigate farmland. The remnants of beautiful pottery and the mysterious rock drawings attested to the factual basis of the legends of an ancient people who once thrived there, then disappeared. Within 150 years, the population of this small farming community would expand exponentially to over 4 million people and growing. That city is Phoenix, the sixth largest city in America. But in an area that produces only 7 inches of rainfall per year, where does all that water come from? Like the mythical bird who rises from the ashes of its own immolation, Phoenix would rise from the remnants of a mysterious ancient civilization, the Hohokam. They lived successfully in the Valley of the Sun for 1,500 years, using an elaborate canal system to irrigate farmland and grow a large variety of food, including beans, corn, squash, cotton, tobacco, and cultivated mesquite trees for shade and for housing. They built elaborate platform mounds to communicate between villages regarding water levels and made careful astronomical calculations to determine the growing seasons for their large variety of crops. Then, around 1500, their civilization was suddenly abandoned. One theory is that as their population grew, it stretched their irrigation system beyond capacity. That, combined with cycles of drought and flooding, overwhelmed their carefully balanced resources.
Fix it in your constitution that no corporation, no body of men, no capital can get possession and right to your waters. Hold the waters in the hands of the people. John Wesley Powell.
In 1869, John Wesley Powell began a journey to survey the then unmapped Colorado River and its canyons. Powell lost three of his men and barely survived, but in the process mapped Grand, Marble, and Glen Canyons. Then Powell made his recommendations to Congress.
I wish to make it clear to you, there is not sufficient water to irrigate all the lands which could be irrigated, and only a small portion can be irrigated. I tell you, gentlemen, you are piling up a heritage of conflict.
Powell wanted to carefully survey where best to develop town sites and irrigation districts to best utilize precious water resources. But other, more powerful forces didn't want to wait.
Godspeed the plow. By this wonderful provision, which is only man's mastery over nature, the clouds are dispensing copious rains and converts a desert into a farm. Rain follows the plow. Charles Dana Wilbur, land speculator.
The government, the railroad, and developers wanted settlers to populate the land west of the Mississippi. But first, they needed to rebrand the area known as the Great American Desert into the Great Plains. It worked. Thousands moved westward in search of a new life. What the government realized was that rain didn't follow the plow, but people would follow the water. This became our nation's official, if unspoken, water policy.
Whiskey is for drinking. Water is for fighting over. Mark Twain, Virginia City, Nevada.
By 1911, the Bureau of Reclamation had completed the Theodore Roosevelt Dam and Roosevelt Lake, the largest dam and reservoir in history. It provided flood control, electricity, and irrigation to the surrounding valley. It soon became a model for the monumental dam projects that were to follow, such as Hoover, Glen Canyon, and Parker Dam. In 1922, the Colorado River Compact was signed by the seven states who share the river. The compact was supposed to allocate the river's water fairly, but the Bureau of Reclamation overestimated the flow of the river by a third. By the time the other states figured this out, California had been given the lion's share. The other states have been fighting court battles for their meager share ever since, especially Arizona, who was allotted only what was left over. Arizona even sent troops to block construction of Parker Dam and protect its remaining share of the Colorado. Arizona only relented when they were allowed to build the Gila River project. But even that wasn't enough.
In the western United States, water flows uphill to money. Glenn Sanders.
In 1968, Lyndon Johnson, whose own political career began with a dam project in West Texas, created the Central Arizona Project. This would use coal-fired pumps to bring Colorado River water more than 336 miles across the desert and over 3,000 feet of mountain ranges to Phoenix and Tucson. So the water does, in fact, flow uphill. Throughout Arizona and the West, dam sites have now been used up, water completely allocated, and resources fully utilized. Yet the population continues to grow.
Everywhere one turned, one saw water, cheap water, inexhaustible water. And when there were no more virgin rivers and aquifers to tap, the illusion was temporarily real.
What was once desert in the Salt River and Casa Grande valleys is now a productive farm and citrus empire. Reclamation has changed Arizona from a bleak frontier to a land of wealth and opulence.
But now the desert is encroaching on the islands of green. The government is broke, the cost of rescue mind-boggling. Mark Reisner.
Mark Reisner's groundbreaking 1987 book, Cadillac Desert, documented the history, triumphs, and failures of the West's water policies. Recently, John Sabo, senior sustainability scientist at Arizona State University's Global Institute of Sustainability, examined Reisner's conclusions using the latest research techniques.
The broadest message of Cadillac Desert is that obviously water is a limiting resource in the West, and that humans have done heroic things to capture it and spread it thinly across the Western landscape. When we spread it thin, we artificially increase water over soils that have high evaporation rates and leave the salt behind. And that salt may, in a sense, poison our agricultural landscape in the future. We've already measured very significant declines in crop revenue and crop production as a result of salt. So the salinity story that Reisner talks about in Cadillac Desert is very valid and has already happened. So stream flow is basically all of the water that you see in rivers across a year. So it's a combination of what runs off from storms directly into the river and what's discharged from groundwater sources into the river as base flow. So humans are appropriating about 76% of that stream flow. A popular benchmark for sustainability is 40%. There's going to be an important tug of war between cities and farms for water as populations increase in cities and as the demand for food also grows. Most people in cities, I think, just don't understand how much water it takes to grow food. Just think about the numbers. 80% of the water that's withdrawn in the West is used for agriculture, and nearly 50% of the farm fields that are irrigated across the West are irrigated by flood irrigation. Moreover, there are many types of irrigation technology that are much more efficient than flood. If we were to convert 50% of that acreage that is irrigated by flood irrigation to something more efficient like drip, you could save an inordinate amount of water. It was somewhere in the range of half to almost the entire volume of Lake Mead per year. And I think the Sun Corridor is projected to be 10 million by in the next 50 years. As we grow as a population in the West, we have to start thinking about what the trade-offs are going to be. Where are we going to allocate water? Are we going to allocate to cities and take that water from farms? Are we going to take that water from ecosystems? Do we want to see all the rivers in the West dry up? Because there simply isn't enough water to continue doing what we're doing and grow at the same time.
According to Michael Hanneman, visiting professor of economics at Arizona State University, implementing a responsive pricing system can encourage conservation.
As supplies have changed, obviously in Arizona, the Central Arizona Project, bringing in water that was a lot more expensive than the groundwater that was being pumped before, that calls for a different pricing mode. One of the most interesting experiments with pricing, which turned out to be very successful, was a small irrigation district in California. That district was unusual in collecting very detailed data on water deliveries. The water use varied from about 2 foot depth of water to almost 4 foot. Tremendous variation. So they switched to a block rate. If you use more water, you could get it, but they put a 50% premium. Immediately, some of the high water users cut down their water use. Within 2 years, nobody was using more than 29 inches. One of the things this illustrates is, while it's important to promote conservation, the low water users basically were doing just fine, and there was no reason why they should change their water use practices. It was the farmers at the other end who were using large amounts. You could grow the same crop without using such a large amount, and it's those farmers you want to target. You give them the option of using a large amount if they want to, but you give them a price incentive to cut back.
Beyond pricing and conservation, the future perhaps rests on innovation. Student researchers, such as Samir Webby, a doctoral candidate at Arizona State University, are experimenting with insightful solutions. He's designed a solar-powered drip irrigation system for farms and lawns.
Well, I come from the Middle East, and I have seen the way it's done. And generally, in here in Arizona also, you can get that water up in your gate for the water for an hour. You run that water. Okay, everything get the water. The weed get the water, the plants get the water. It flood the area. And that's not an effective way of utilizing or using that water. Let's take a tree. Put the water enough where it reaches the bottom of the root, where the tree is being nourished. However, you don't want the water to go below those roots, the bottom of the roots, because then you will be wasting water. It does depend on the moisture content of the soil. Different parts of the world have different soils. How can we standardize that where we can come up with one system that could be used everywhere? So I figured out most sands have the same characteristics and it behaves the same with moisture content everywhere. In the area you want to irrigate, you put those props, part of those props, in sand. Therefore, you standardized the soil characteristics. The system consists of two probes and the membrane, which could be connected to the computer, which can be programmed. The first probe at the top of the roots, it'll test the water content there. Is there enough water in there? If there isn't, it'll turn the system on. And then the system will take over and will check the bottom of the roots. Did the water arrive to the bottom of the roots? And then it'll stop. Could be used for commercial use or residential use. And here in Arizona, and we know the water is very scarce, the system could be utilized very effectively.
The tradition of the Pima people states that the Hohokam declined because they became arrogant and complacent, believing that nature would always be at their command.
We've recently completed what's titled the Colorado River Basin Water Supply and Demand Study. It was about a 3-year effort, and the objective of that study was to project how water supply and demand may change on the Colorado River Basin over the next 50 years. Supply is decreasing, especially when you consider the impacts of climate change. You're seeing about a 9% decrease in our long-term future average compared to what we've historically seen on the basin. And then we're also seeing an increase in demand, ranging from 18 million to about 20.5 million acre feet of total Colorado River demand over the next 50 years. What's driving the demand is really population growth. So we're seeing population in some cases double under certain scenarios, and that really causes major increases in demand for municipal and industrial water. We're also seeing changes in water use efficiency. We are getting more efficient over time, but that's not counteracting that growth in population.
We Americans are spoiled. We wake up in the morning, we turn on the tap, and out comes as much water as we want for less than we pay for cell phone service or for cable television.
Water use is important to Intel for several reasons. We want to look at how we can reduce the amount of water that we use as a company. As industry, we're trying to look at our water usage more holistically and look at our entire water footprint as it relates to the products and services that we provide. Here in Arizona, we partnered with the city of Chandler to build a water treatment facility whereby water from our plant is sent, is treated, and then re-injected into the groundwater. That then allows the city to store water for future use.
When most of our fellow citizens think about water, they think of it as though it were the air, infinite and inexhaustible, when for all practical purposes, it's very finite and quite exhaustible.
A lot of people are projected to move to this area over the next 50 years, and that's really increasing our demand for water. We looked at a broad range of different options to kind of bring that imbalance of supply and demand closer together. We looked at municipal conservation, agriculture conservation, different ways to import water into the basin, so increase the supply. We looked at different options that dealt with modifying the way we operate our reservoirs. We built a water banking scheme for the upper basin that we considered. Reuse was definitely an option.
What we did to the buffalo is what we're trying our darndest to do to our water supply. It and many species in the ocean and other animals we harvested close to extinction. But we can do better than that, and we should do better than that, because the options are there.
Each semiconductor device uses roughly 10 to 15 gallons of water to manufacture. Reuse water is of high enough quality for us to use in industrial systems. Cooling towers, irrigation, those types of applications that are industrial in nature, where the water doesn't need to be drinking water quality, are perfect applications for reuse. It's not just how much water we're using as an industry in the location where we happen to be, but how much water is our supplier using, who's perhaps located halfway around the world and in a region where water is scarce. One other activity that we've recently engaged in with CH2M Hill, we are matching producers of reuse water with potential users of reuse water, such that more reuse water occurs.
Golly, we have not recognized that our water supply is like a milkshake glass, and each demand for water is a straw in the glass, and instead we've just let people put new straws into the glass. Until you rest the idea of more straws going into the glass, you're not going to get the right incentives for reuse.
We evaluated up to about 1 million acre feet of reuse for some of the major municipal areas throughout the basin. So here in Arizona, Southern California, areas up in the upper basin, Salt Lake City, Denver. That was found to be a really significant, important piece of what we think the solution is moving forward.
The mayor told me that the well's head went dry. It actually lost 19 feet of water last year, and this year it was below the pump. We actually didn't have any water in the system. I contacted the Socorro County Emergency Management Group, and we formed a plan to have water trucked in from the very large array, which is 20 miles west, New Mexico Tech in Socorro and the city of Socorro. Water was rationed, no watering outside, no laundry. You can use the water, it's on a boil alert. We had forest fires, so all the water tenders were being used in other areas. And all the water trucks that we could get, of course, had to be certified. They had to be a certified water truck. They just couldn't be a fire truck or a water truck from anywhere. We want to make sure that the lines are clean after we trucked in about 50,000 gallons of water a day. But after the 7 days was up, I suggested that we go ahead and start pumping the well again to see if it replenished. They actually put another 10 feet of pipe on it, on the pump, and got it down into the water basin and started pumping again, and it hasn't lost any levels at this point. Now, from talking to the old well drillers around, you would never have to drill a well 300 feet around here. And so now we're down 300 feet and lower, down to 300, 500, 550. To get 10 gallons a minute or 20 gallons a minute for wells. I think people really understand now that they've been out, totally out. Whenever you can't take a shower, use the toilet facilities, you can't do anything, that affects people. And I believe in the back of their mind, they'll always remember this and say, we're gonna use this much water for this and this much water for that, and that's all we're gonna do.
It begs the question, who's going to pay for higher efficiency, and how are we going to essentially squeeze more water out of rock as we grow as big cities into the future? The thing that we ought to really be thinking about is using treated effluent to water landscapes. Just about 50% of the water we use at the home is used outside to water lawns and other sorts of landscaping. And so you could achieve a significant amount of savings in the city by having a dual system, one which delivers drinkable water through blue pipes to your kitchen and your faucets, and the other one that delivers gray water through purple pipes to your yard.
We have people that want to have tremendous gardens, lawns, swimming pools, which is great if you have the water supply. But if you don't, it really needs to be conserved.
The The word hohokam is a Tohono O'odham word meaning those who have vanished.
In spite of all those heroic engineering feats, we still are at a precipice with water. There's still likely not enough for farms, for cities, and for ecosystems in the future.
Only by bringing the forces of policy, innovation, and personal conservation can people continue to thrive in the West.